that it's all about asking the right questions and learning how to get actionable insights out of data. That's really the heart and soul of data science.
George, thanks for joining the show. I appreciate you coming on.
Well, it's a great pleasure. Thanks for having me.
We've never had a data scientist on the show. First of all, what is a data scientist? Tell me about the start of your career and how eventually you moved on to doing more commercial real estate.
Yeah, so really it was all about more freedom and becoming a data scientist. Certainly that gave me a lot more freedom than I had when I was in bioscience, not having to supervise experiments all night. But yeah, what is data science? It's really about me repurposing that PhD and making use of it. Or as I like to say, I'm a recovering PhD. So I wanted to be able to go out into industry and make some really good money. But again, you know, it's not really the money so much that gives you the freedom. It's having that flexibility over your schedule. And that was lacking.
So previously bioscientist. So tell me the stuff that you were doing there. Give me some of, what'd you work on?
Yeah, well, I worked in three different fields, microbiology. I worked also in genomics and physiology, and it was a great ride. It was very exciting. I have over 800 citations for a research show. It was very well received, but again, total lack of personal freedom, but very, very exciting lifestyle.
So you did that. Eventually, I believe you got into the mortgage industry. What exactly were you analyzing? What'd you figure out?
Essentially, we work in the mortgage industry, and I was doing predictive analytics, and I did a lot of work that helps us to understand the accuracy of models and predicting when models are going off the rails sooner, because these models were designed to potentially save the company millions of dollars in the event of turbulence in the macroeconomic environment. And if we can figure out even, you know, a day, a week, a month earlier that these models are off, so much the better for our company.
So your data alerts them, hey, I'm seeing an issue here. We're going to find this out before someone else. Give us an example of what you would find out.
Right. Okay. So basically the idea is we were trying to figure out the likelihood of closing a loan, because what we had to do is we, like all non-bank lenders, you have to hedge that ahead of time. And really the hardest thing to do is to predict the likelihood of that loan's closing. And so what I did that was really groundbreaking is that I took a look at our models and tried to figure out, you know, when they were going wrong. And it really takes, you know, like say a full 3 months for these things to bake, for us to get the idea of whether we're actually really right on the money, because a lot of loans take a long, long time to close. And when we talk about accuracy, we're talking, you know, tenths of a percentage point could easily be very significant sums of money. So the idea was just keep an eye on the accuracy of the model and start to look for ways in which we can determine that they're going off the rails earlier. And it turned out to be very instrumental. And that's what I won the award for.
Did you end up taking some of this data when you went on your own to invest in commercial real estate? Or did you utilize this modeling or no?
Yeah, so I did build some models in my own career, but I wouldn't say that that was terribly useful. What I really say that it's all about is asking the right questions and learning how to get actionable insights out of data. That's really the heart and soul of data science. So there's a lot to it. You know, it's everything from linear regression to machine learning, deep learning, talking about neural networks, all these things. But really, whatever you use, whatever tool it is, what really matters, if you're able to get those actionable insights, the data is gold.
So you wanted to go into commercial real estate. Where'd you start?
So it really did come from the data science days. I just scanned the entire landscape of investing and decided that multifamily investing was the best place to be.
And why was that?
Well, pre-pandemic, you could see we had super low rates, total housing crisis. And having the opportunity to go out there into the free market and to use all that freedom to solve a problem and to make some money doing it really made a lot of sense to me. And again, that housing crisis, it's huge. It's ongoing. And there is a need for people to continue to come into real estate, to continue to improve our housing stock, whether it's buying Class C and converting it into Class B through renovation or building new. And I've been involved in both.
Even when the market was very good and rates were low, I mean, man, the amount of commercial space I would see out in the DMV area where I am, kind of out a little bit more in Virginia, that was completely unleased. And this was before COVID. So, you know, what happens to those properties? And you know, let's call them maybe Class C or B. You know, what happens to those properties? I mean, eventually they get torn down because they're just not needed, or do they get converted into something else?
That is what needs to happen. But in other cases, it's a matter of redevelopment, whether, you know, taking a hotel, turning it into multifamily or maybe taking, you know, condominiums, turning them into, or vice versa, either way, depending on which market, which way the market's going, where they have more tenants or not. You know, I think redevelopment is, it's a very huge part of the market. Not something I particularly like. It's very dangerous. It's almost like ground up construction. In some ways, it's worse because once you open up the walls, as they say on TV, price went up.
Yeah, sure. Absolutely.
Yeah.
Tell me about your book. You got a book. It talks about passive income, but I also read about being active as a passive income. Tell me about it.
Yeah, absolutely. So my book is Passionate Living Through Passive Investing. And it's a lot of things. It's your introduction, your primer to the whole world of private markets. It's my personal story. And it's really all about my way of approaching growing your wealth mindfully. So what that means to me is that you really have to focus on that personal growth. And I'd like to use the metaphor of the number one CapEx project is you. A lot of people, they spend all this time on their business plan, whether it's some operating business or some real estate. They spend all this time on, you know, renovations, CapEx, improving the bottom line, and sometimes to the neglect of ourselves. So you got to make sure that you're out there every day growing who you are. That'll grow your bottom line. And growing who you are in your personal life. Another thing that I do is I like to really focus on how you don't have to be wealthy to live the life of Riley. I've had some of the best times of my life on a $5,000 sailboat. Not cheap, but we're not talking a yacht either. You know, I go and see those yachts in the marina. A lot of times they're never moved. These giant, beautiful boats. And I wonder, when does the owner actually have the time to get out there on the yacht and move it? Or they even have the money? I mean, these things burn gas like crazy. So, or diesel, I should say. But the point is that if you find relatively inexpensive ways to love your life today, there's no reason why you should just go around chasing numbers all day, every day for decades, year after year, until you become old and gray.
Yeah, give us some examples of the best things you provided, examples in your book of kind of how you improved your life and, you know, and maybe how it happened through an investment or something.
Right. Well, I think, you know, the first would be the, you know, the issue of sailing. Then I started dancing. My wife, now she loves to dance. I just love it because she's working from home. She's totally free herself. She does some bookkeeping and gets to do it right around the children. But anyway, she's smiling right now because I'm talking about how she learned to love to dance too. So she's going and learning Argentine tango. We get to do all of these wonderful things. And it's cheap too, like $150. And I get to go to all you can eat lessons for a month. And again, you know, you don't have to be super wealthy to just learn to live and love your life every night. It's like a ready-made date every night of the week.
Nice. What's the biggest thing you learned, you know, in terms of very bad steps or red flags in terms of investing?
Number one, I think, is just putting your emotions in check, and many different ways that I do that. Like I go through, you know, the Zen of investing in the book, The Three Poisons. And these are things like we've heard, but I want to put a new framework, like, you know, moha, ignorance or delusion. That's represented by the pig in Zen Buddhism. And how this affects us is that sometimes we think we know everything, right? Like, I'm so good at what I do. You know, hey, I write books about it. People, you know, they write to me wanting to invest in my deals. Never think that you know it all or that you even know enough, because the world is always changing and you got to always educate yourself. So, you know, I do it many ways. Part of it is through continuous education, and then also just educating yourself about human nature and more importantly, you know, how you approach things. Understanding how, you know, you get too excited about a deal. And you know, maybe you say, hey, I've got the money to invest in this deal. But what happens if things go wrong? Can you handle the capital calls that might come up? Because that's something that happens. And people get very, you know, excited about something and they end up throwing good money after bad. So what I would say that a person needs to do, always educate yourself, and then don't neglect the softer side of things. Understand your personality and the way you approach things, and make sure that you're not allowing yourself to be emotional, because there's so many levels we can be emotional on. Whether it's the most famous one, of course, is the fear of missing out. FOMO is the investor's worst enemy. Or you know, maybe just letting something slip on due diligence. You know, we always have to maintain that constant vigilance.
So I actually had this conversation with my business partner. And so we own a title company, LA Title and Escrow. And, you know, I have not done a good job of investing in a lot of real estate over the course of my life, right? So, I mean, we have all these people we see that are in here buying houses on a weekly basis, you know, continuing to build up this portfolio. And what I was telling him was, you know what? You know, I'm in my mid to late 40s. And, you know, there's still time. You know, like, I mean, I could buy a house a year for the next 10 years and, you know, still be in my mid 50s and own 10 properties. Like, I think there's always this rush and FOMO that, hey, you need to be buying all these homes. You need to be doing it quickly. You're too old. Life moves quickly and hopefully we live longer. And still my mid 50s, hopefully I'm not too old to still enjoy it.
Yeah, absolutely. And, you know, a lot of times people feel like, oh gosh, I'm late to the game. What do I do? And watch out for that FOMO. There's always the next cycle. And remember, commercial real estate is different than residential real estate. We've seen those two out of joint for many, many years. Now, during an up cycle, they usually trend up together. But when things get a little turbulent, as they have been since the Great Recession, you know, there are times that you could have invested very well in residential real estate, which recovered like this. Commercial real estate has really only been recovering since 2024, particularly multifamily. But now maybe residential real estate is kind of on the downturn in many markets. So again, I would just say, keep your eyes open. Sometimes the person who's fashionably late to the party is just on time.
I remember reading that. I like that quote. That was good. Cool. Well, we have a rapid fire section. Book or podcast that changed the way you do business?
So I'm going to have to say Dale Carnegie, How to Win Friends and Influence People.
It's a great book. I've had many of the smart people I know I've talked to about their favorite books, and that one's come up many of the times. Name an asset class you wouldn't touch in today's market.
Anything crypto or green. I don't know how to value crypto, and I think green is a lot of excitement there. Watch out.
And when you say green, are you talking about solar or what do you mean by that?
Yeah, exactly. So some of these things make sense. Some of them don't. Like, for example, ethanol doesn't really make any sense at all from the standpoint of science and technology. It makes a lot of sense if you're getting subsidized to make that. So you got to watch out for that. If the government can yank the rug out on from under you, that's really bad. And again, when things get hyped, that's also dangerous. I mean, look at Tesla stock. It's gone parabolic how many times? And I think, you know, at some point, you know, Elon pretty much is the king of the world, as much as that can be the case. But is something like that going to be a good investment going forward? It's hard to say whether that makes financial sense.
First thing you do after wiring funds into a new deal?
Yeah, so the first thing I do is breathe a sigh of relief, but I also like to update the investment thesis. So take a look at, why did you invest in this? You know, have your ideas and views changed? Make sure you record what you were thinking when you invested in it, because later on, as you go through those speed bumps, that's when you get to revet your vetting process.
Real estate or biotech? Which is more unpredictable?
Well, I would say biotech for sure, but in where there's volatility, there's opportunity. So look for those volatile fields.
Let's talk about biotech. I used to live in San Diego. There was a lot of biotech out there. Did you ever live there or work there yourself?
No, but actually I did win the opportunity to go out to a conference in San Diego. It's billed as America's finest city. And after seeing it, I'm inclined to agree.
And, you know, look, like you said, I mean, I remember there were some different times when I was there where they were doing great and these stocks were going to be huge. I believe now we're probably in a bad time, I would assume, for biotech from what I've seen. Is that accurate?
Well, you know, I haven't followed biotech so much, which may seem kind of odd because that's where I have a lot of experience, you know, having worked in three different fields in bioscience. But what I will tell you is that I do love these volatile fields. I'm always looking at shipping. Shipping is monolithic. People are worried about tariffs, but understand what that impacts, mainly container shipping. People say, well, it's all the Houthis and them shutting down the strait. Well, you know what? It doesn't have anything to do with, you know, for example, bulk shipping. It has very little to do with that shipping lane. So you don't have to worry about the Suez Canal so much if you're investing in bulk shipping. So, you know, look for these volatile fields, and where you find a volatile asset class, just sit and wait, understand it in detail, and you can have the opportunity to make a big killing. Well, here's another one. You can see that commodities are trading at all-time low versus the S&P 500. So take that either way you want it, that S&P is probably, you know, overpriced, it probably is a bit, or that commodities are just way undervalued and you're going to find some opportunities there. So look where other people are not looking.
Yeah, no, I like that. In fact, I still remember very clearly there was, Dry Ships. Do you know that company?
That crazy. I remember the founder and I remember, you know, just that I've never seen a company that volatile. And I'd love to hear your story about Dry Ships. But for me, the story is that no matter how well you ever do, if you dilute your investors like a million fold, I'm just pulling that number out of a hat, that you know, you can't win.
Sure. I remember, I mean, the stock was going parabolic, right? This was, over 10 years ago. I remember I was following the stock market at a time. Actually, I believe it was like 2016. And I remember like looking at this thing, it was up from like $3 to $12, you know, in that morning on Yahoo Finance. And I was like, you know, I was about to go on a 5-hour drive. And I was like, hey, you know what? Maybe I'll throw some money in here. I never did. I never did throw it. By the time I got to the 5-hour location, it was at like $90, right? Like this thing had gone up so much in one day. The next day it was at like 140. The next day it was at 400. I remember like CNBC being like, this makes absolutely no sense. But it doesn't mean that this stock also won't go to 2000. There was a time back in the day, which I'm forgetting what it was, many, many hundreds of years ago. Do you remember this, where something was outrageously valuable?
Well, yeah, there's 100. There's like the South Sea bubble, the tulip mania.
Yeah, the tulip
and
mania.
Here's my favorite is the Missouri company.
What was it?
The Scotsman, John Law, I think he got in trouble in the UK, or the Great Britain at the time was the proper name. And he had to be forced to exit. He went to France and he told everybody, you know, to buy up this land at the time they were calling it, you know, the West, Missouri. So he sent all these shares in this company. He tried to get people to populate the land. And of course, that's the great story of the American West, that the French never did populate the land. Napoleon needed money and ended up selling that land eventually to the United States. But in the meantime, people just went nuts over it.
I haven't looked at that industry in a long time, but I'm assuming, like you said, shipping is probably in a pretty bad spot with all the stuff that you name. However, if these trade deals get put in place and there's clarity there, maybe those stocks make a run. I don't know. What do you think of that?
Well, there's another thing. First of all, you have to understand that people always overreact. And certainly, I'm not going to lie to you, these tariffs are a bad thing for our economy. But, you know, if you don't mind me just telling you the God honest truth, I mean, our sure. president is an economic genius. He's not going to crash our economy and keep these horrible tariffs in place. And so you see these, you know, the haters, they want to go and sell all their stocks. And that turned out not to be the right thing to do, because as you pointed out, the trade deals come in. And to be fair, we're ending up with tariffs that are higher than what we had before. It's not good for the economy, but it's nowhere near the disaster that was predicted. So absolutely, if you can, you can't really predict it, but if you can see when people have just absolutely gone bonkers, gone nuts, panic selling, that's always the time to jump in. And again, take a look at what isn't impacted as much. Container shipping is hugely impacted. The moment you slap some sort of a tariff on China, you're going to see that those container ports are going empty. But other things like bulk shipping that provides the ore for the basic industries, you know, that's a lot slower to respond. And so again, just really understanding in great depth what those companies are doing. And by the way, since we mentioned shipping, look at the alignment between the shareholders and the management. Companies like dry ships that are diluting people into oblivion are never going to be a good investment. But, you know, there are many companies that are much more disciplined in their capital allocation. So yeah, look for those opportunities.
On the bulk shipping front, do you have a recommendation? Is an ETF, a specific company? What are you looking at?
How about this? I will tell you something even better than my personal recommendations, which I could, but I follow Jay Mintzmyer. And if you go to Seeking Alpha, he is one of the top, not just in shipping where he's the tip of the top, but one of the top analysts. And, you know, go take a look at what he's writing, and he'll really help people to understand what's going on. Yeah, there's so many things. You got your dirty tankers, clean tankers. I mean, it's way too much to go into.
Based on your time currently today, how much is it spent on commercial real estate versus investing and opportunities completely outside real estate? Is it a combination, or what does it look like?
Yeah, you know, it is a combination. Family construction company wrapped up their first project. So I've been looking for new opportunities, operating businesses, more real estate. Sometimes I'm operating it, sometimes not. Really, I just want to go where the opportunities are the best. That's where I want to take my investors. You do have to stay in your lane to a certain degree, but you know exactly where you're at in commercial real estate, that can change. You know, look for those niches, be willing to change. We started out in the Southeast. Then, you know, I tried to move north a little faster than most people, because that Sunbelt really, I think, has suffered a lot of pain. But I mean, that's the thing you need to do. You need to be able to pivot. You should pivot often, but there's an art to pivoting just the right amount. I mean, I'm not going from real estate to fine art.
Where do you currently live?
I'm in Michigan, where I've lived my entire life. I love it. Love the Great Lakes. Love to sail the Great Lakes. And this is where my family and I just love living life.
Tell us if people want to, you know, learn more about some of your investment theses on the commercial front or other fronts. What's the best way to find you and you know, read your books? Where do they go?
Yeah, absolutely. You can find me at www.robertscapitalenterprises.com. If you want to find my book, just go to Amazon or Audible, and I would love a review. I greatly appreciate everybody who's read the book and who's left me a 5-star review.
Well, George, look, I appreciate the time. It's definitely a unique perspective for the podcast, but I like it. I like the data. You know, we're a data company. We ask every single customer we work with how we did. If we ever get anything under a 5-star review, we give them a call, even if it's a 4 out of 5. And we have over 15,000 5-star reviews as a result. Data works. Follow the data. It's successful. Mm-hmm. It works.